He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D. Tony D'Angelo.
All right, every Tuesday, Tony D'Angelo joins us right here on the radio. You can find him on Twitter, TonyD'Angelo7. He's also got his own YouTube channel where he puts out some great content each and every Thursday, which is a must-watch/listen. Good morning, Tony. How are you?
Good morning, Lee Elci. Good morning, everybody. Proud to be among you.
So I know you have an agenda today, but you're not calling an audible, but you wanted to start where?
Well, let's start with, you know, I inspired by your most excellent monologue, I really think that we're at a point right now in the state and the country where the frog is in the water, the water's getting warmer, and it's an inflection point. You know, the frog's either got to decide to, you know, jump out or be cooked. And I was thinking about this yesterday, because actually having a discussion with our good friend Jan. The rules are the rules are the rules. You know, we're supposed to have given axioms in society. You know, we watch a baseball game. We don't want to see basketball rules in that. I mean, the things we always talk about, you know, voting, personal safety, criminal prosecution, a right to privacy. And, you know, in a, I'm going to use the word cesspool of what has really become Connecticut, you know, the standards of governance, information getting out, the right information getting out, without a political color on it. This whole thing in Bridgeport is just the perfect example of all of that. In passing around yesterday, I was paying attention. Actually, I believe Jan might have mentioned this to me. Hunter Biden, of all people, filed suit in the D.C. District Court about how the IRS misused and abused his rights to confidentiality. It's a law. If you keep in score at home, Section 6103, it is sacrosanct. And I thought about that, and the first thing I thought is, you weasel. But then I also thought that, you know, this law is there for everybody, even the Hunter Bidens of the world. Now, hearken back, you know, to the wonderful world of Ned and keeping us safe and COVID and the government knows best. Put your head down, shuffle along, and follow. 3.5 years ago on this show, I came out and I took the contract and I dissected it and I put slides up. You know, the Josh Gabal, our chief of staff in the regime of King Governor Ned Lamont, accountable, gave our identities, gave all our state identities away to Boston Consulting Group. And I went to everybody. You know I went to everybody. I went to my Turkey state senator and state legislator and said, what the hell are you going to do about this? One of them was a cop. Nothing. Absolutely, positively nothing. And it's the same damn rule. It's the same damn thing. And the only thing that I'm saying, I had not originally intended to start with that, but when we start to accept something in society, you know, this whole thing, like you played the Ned tapes earlier, but you know, I really don't know. Stephanie Thomas comes out and says something like, you know, it was is so vague as to be indistinguishable. You know, this is what they do. They're going to pay off their people to cover for them. I mean, Lee Elci, I don't want to confess sickness, but I am sick of this. You're bald.
This is, again, one of my biggest pet peeves, Tony, this idea of disenfranchising the voter. It's the game's over, if that's the case.
It is entirely over.
It's over. We cannot come back from a place where people don't think that their vote counts and their opinions count. It wrecks the republic, and it's the end of democracy, period. End of story.
Well, that's just it. I mean, all the things that, you know, back to, you know, the given axioms in society. And that kind of takes us to Saudi Annie, the classic Connecticut thing. You know, couple of articles, couple of things. Oh, you know, Annie's doing the same thing Bob did and. And I have maintained on this show it is much bigger than that because we don't know what the agenda is. We can piece together some things. I think we did a decent job of that last show. But when you get to Saudi Annie, you know, those have been following. Our senior senator in Connecticut, Dick Blumenthal, has been off on the PGA Golf and LIV merger, and that's led him to a major investigation of the Saudi Public Investment Fund. Now, this past week, I believe it was Wednesday, He called for subpoenas of everything and everyone involved. Now, that would be the consulting companies and the government. The consulting companies would be McKinsey, Boston Consulting, and Teneo, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. And when you look at this and you say to yourself, in a state that is showing every bit of being ungovernable, where it's not serious, where the policy is not serious, if you could even find the policy, for crying out loud, I sit there and I say, well, if it takes a Senate subpoena, you know, the return date on that's October 13th. We're going to be watching that date very closely. You should go on the, I encourage people to do this, go on the Blumenthal website, read the letters. I'm going to excerpt, you know, maybe one or two of them later, and see what he's actually asking for. He is asking for every single thing, including the kitchen sink. It will tell us when it's there, who's involved and what and where and when. Our state legislature is not going to give us that. The corporate media is not going to give us that. It oddly takes this Democrat senator who was doing this for a motive I'm not entirely clear on to bring everything here, to which I say, good, you know, because this is what it takes to do something. Connecticut cannot govern itself. Connecticut has no interest in governing itself. But, I mean, where does it lead us? And, I mean, this is where I'm just kind of looking with great interest. Does it take us, you know, I know George Colley talks about the date. I think it was long before any time anybody might have even become interested in that, just my personal opinion. But does it take us to advanced CT, and advanced CT is talking about wind power, or the Saudis are in wind power? I mean, this is where I think no one in Ned's circle is asking these questions. The state media is certainly not pressuring him. If you looked, what I would encourage our listeners to do, George posted this last night, and I'm grateful. Study Ned Lamont's mannerisms, his inflections, his eyes, his face. When he's being asked these very wan questions by his pet press people, and I'll tell you, this is the calculus that's playing off in the guy's head, because he knows if something's out there, it's just, it's essentially going to blow his entire governorship back to, you know, ground zero as a sham and a charade, which largely it is, because the jig's up, the game's over. I mean, that's where I'm at on this thing. So, and let me just say this. This is something, at this point, the cart is going down the hill. I don't think the Saudis are going to capitulate and give everything over and repent and all that. They're going to claim, you know, sovereign immunity and all this other stuff. But the consulting companies, they're going to roll over like a cheap kid's wagon, because they want to continue to do business. And, you know, they'll be hired by somebody to go do something else. But it's like, you know, I look at this and I say, how bizarre, how crazy. Nobody can keep a scam up forever. And I look at this somewhat with relief.
So what's your, I mean, if you had to make a line, like a betting line, as to whether or not Blumenthal would ever, you know, investigate something that Ned Lamont does. I mean, you mentioned him, and it seems like everything and anything on the peripherals, he wants to go out and investigate, whether it's the Coast Guard, the NFL, the players, golf, you know, the golf guys or whomever. It's always something, but it's never anything that, you know, seemingly is, not that those aren't important, but it doesn't seem like he ever wants to attack what's right in front of him.
Oh, I definitely think there's political posturing. I mean, there's no question about that. It's almost like you have to take the crumbs that come out of the table and see what's meaningful. He will do things that will make him look as if he's doing a lot of things, and some of the things are meaningful, and some of the things are like, hey, so what? But I, you know, the how could I put it? You know, as we discussed earlier, the motive here is I don't know. I mean, I think he's just looking beyond Ned. I think he's looking to the future. What future he's looking at? He's always wanted to be, at least in the public, this great you know, beacon of defense for the military and the 9/11 families. I mean, I think we'll know a lot more as we go on, but yeah, I have the same questions you do.
All right, here's one for you. So, and we're talking with Tony D'Angelo, TonyD'Angelo7 on Twitter. Follow him. Again, he's got his own great YouTube channel as well, where he releases at least one great video every single week. If we were to actually go after Ned Lamont and his wife with a unbiased, full-out investigation, would there be enough there to send him to jail?
Well, that's a very good question. My humble opinion, yes, I believe so. Because it's not, I mean, put it this way, the old kind of Boss Tweed fraud, you know, the Tammany Hall fraud, what they called in history class honest graft. This is not, fastball, curveball kind of. This is complex. This involves multiple levels. And when we look at our, you know, bodies of justice, which are supposed to be the Justice Department, the FBI, and what they're not doing, I mean, I think this is just not as big as a bag of potatoes, but they're just simply not processing. Now, if you go way back, 3.5 years ago, I was talking to not a great length, but a moderate length. One of William Barr's investigators, actually, this was the guy that was in charge of the COVID funds. And I said, look, you have this, and this. And he said, yes, that's real. That's right. Thank you for sharing it. Never heard a word from him. I don't know. I mean, but basically, I think from the top down, you know, you think going after a mom in a classroom, protesting about her kids, a whole lot worse than something like this. Yes, I think in a normal world, there certainly is enough to prosecute him. Now, of course, what that would be people aggressively calling his, malfeasance and his peccadilloes at everything. He hasn't had that, you know. So basically, yeah, it's there. But, you know, we live in such an upside-down world. That's why we're not seeing it.
All right. Switching from that, Tony, you want to talk about a perfect storm?
Yeah, we're headed for one. Think about this. This is the world we're now living in, you know, for all the little things that go on locally around us. We've got a writer strike in Los Angeles, and the thing that people don't understand about strikes, certainly what politicians don't understand, is that when that person on that job is losing his income, he's not spending, he's not going out and getting things, he's not going on vacations. Strikes have a major rippling effect. Now, so we've got the UAW strike. We've got illegal aliens are swarming the borders into the sanctuary cities. We've got uncontrolled crime. You talked about that this morning. We're headed for a government shutdown on September 30th, and the student loan payments are going to resume again. Thank you, Miguel Cardona, for lying to everybody and, you know, trying to do something which you know knew defied gravity, and you lied to these people, and they voted for this, you know, president that couldn't deliver the goods. Now, this is a toxic stew, and when you go particularly, let's just look at how this all kind of filters down here into Connecticut. When you look at the E Car thing, go back to the Inflation Reduction Act, and what happened was the big three. Now, these are people that, how could I put it? They'll tell you anything that they want to tell you, but they're essentially kind of, fingers on the hand of the political system. That's going on for years. They said, oh, look, there's, you know, they wouldn't care if they produce bottle caps pretty much typically as long as they have, you know, made a product. And as some of the cars they made over the years as a former Chevy Vega, the owner, they might have produced bottle caps and done a better job. But basically they said, okay, time to get rid of Donald Trump. He doesn't want anything. They dumped all kinds of money into this thing. Now, we look at Detroit. And we look at the history of Detroit and the history of the UAW. This is not something brand new. This has gone on for years and years and years and years and years. If you have nothing to do, maybe if you have something to do, go pull Lee Iacocca's autobiography talking about, his life in Ford Motor Company, dealing with Henry Ford and how the patriarchy was working there, and it was, you know, racism, classism, drunkenness. Drunkenness was a big thing in Detroit, because what are you going to do on a winter night, 5 o'clock, the plant shuts down, you're going to drink until 8 o'clock the next morning. My brother was high up in the automobile industry. I saw all this. So go to 2008, right? What happened in 2008? These three turkey CEOs come to Congress begging for money, you know, screwed up beyond belief. And it's like, well, how'd you get here? Well, we flew here in our corporate jets. Well, you know, go back and drive here in your cars and we'll give you the money. This is the way this thing has worked forever. And it's like, it's when you look at it, and I take all of this down, you know, we've got this perfect storm happening economically. And the guy that's headed Ford for the past couple of years, Jim Farley. And now put it this way: he drank the Biden Kool-Aid. I have no sympathy for him, but and I will also say that the people that head these outfits are not necessarily the sharpest knives in the drawer. But he said the quiet part out loud this week, and what he said was, you know, people really don't want these e-cars. You know, they're expensive, they're limited range, they're good for the educated buyer that, you know, wants to like stay close and, you know, think they're doing something. This is not a market that's sustainable. Now, when you see that and when you look at that, we look at our state, you know, which basically we're going to do green forever. We're going to do green no matter what. We're not going to have any pushback about the green. Now, I am environmentally respectful, but you have to ask yourself something. If these cars are, and I think the whole farce of them being made as far as what they do to the world ecology is, you know, beyond the whole thing, if I plug this thing in, aren't I really great? I'm not doing a carbon footprint here, but, you know, God knows what it took to get there. But when you get to this whole thing and you say, can they even produce these stupid cars? Is there enough minerals? Is there enough anything? And, like, are we really talking? Is anybody in this state asking about, well, if we go off on this thing of e-cars 2035 and life is great and all this other kind of stuff, is this going to, like, where transportation, personal transportation will not be available to people? You know, assumedly, if you're not selling gas cars, you're not going to sell gas. And, you know, these e-cars aren't going to have enough things. And is this some grand Marxist design to have only the elite drive cars? I don't know, but there has to be somewhere, I guess I said all that to say this, an adult in the room to come out and say, you know, our Republican Party can't push back at this like a feather duster. It's like, hey, this is crazy. We keep doing this, we're going to be in some terrible condition as time goes on. Look at what happened in California yesterday. Gavin Newsom, right now, that's our role model. You know, possibly the presidential candidate came out and said, well, I want every single large corporation to report its emissions, you know, to report its foot. Now, okay, environmental child in Connecticut, economic and environmental child, come out and say, well, you know, what about Pratt & Whitney? Maybe they should do that, or the sub base, or the casino, you know, because this is really what it's all about, climate change, right? I mean, I don't know if people are seeing this, and I mean, it's like, I go out of my, to me, it's like so obvious, and when you take this back to this economic perfect storm of all these other things, it's like, I try not to think about it, but I say, Lee Elci, where are we headed? This is like a journey into bizarro world, and not only that, but you can't trust what the people are telling you, and I guess like Mark Levin says, I'm through.
It's a dismantling of the free market system, is what.
Purely.
Because without, I mean, the free market system would dictate whether or not people would want to go out and buy an electric car. If it works, they'll buy it. If it goes like a gas-powered car and is in the same price range, they'll go get it because that's the way things work.
Let the market work. And none of the political system wants to let the market work, because I think after a while it would obviate the silliness of what the political system's trying to do to the market.
All right. Tony, where can folks find out your YouTube page where they got to go watch?
Okay. Tony D'Angelo's PM Coast to Coast. You can look me up. I do post the videos every Thursday at 3 p.m. I do put it up on Twitter. You can also watch it on YouTube, and I do post the recorded show on the Friday Lee Elci stream with your permission and your courtesy, and I'm very grateful for that.
Well, thank you, buddy. Thank you for all you do. I'll talk to you next time.
Thanks, Tom.
All right, Tony D'Angelo, check him out. Great follow on Twitter. We'll be right back. Flax joins us in the studio next.